This is joint work with Haris and Hervé, and I'm going to talk about a very simple story, a social choice model. So I will just start from a model. So it's very much same setting as, for example, one about Felix Brandt was talking earlier today, but with much more simple preferences. So we have finite number of agents and finite number of mutually exclusive alternatives. And the agents have to agree on a lottery over those alternatives or outcomes. There are several interpretations of the story. One is that indeed, you know, there are several mutually exclusive outcomes, and we agree on a lottery with some weights, and then we perform a lottery, and some outcome comes up, and if lottery assigns a larger number to some alternative, it means that this alternative has larger chance to come out, right? So that's a lottery interpretation. You also can think about this model in different ways. You can think that this lottery represents time shares of those outcomes. For example, agents have to agree on what type of TV program is broadcasting. It could be news program or sport program or soap opera type. And then agents together should decide which fraction of time news are broadcasting and which fraction of time the sport is broadcasting. Right, so you can think about time shares. You can also think about this lottery representing shares of resources. Like we have several, our outcomes are projects on which we want to spend money. We have fixed budget, one unit of budget. And then we have to allocate this budget between several projects, like city council decides between several projects how to improve the, you know, the public, how improve the city, whether we want to construct a swimming pool or a public park or improve local hospital or whatever. And again, we want to decide which fraction of our budget goes to which project. Okay, so that's the idea. And actually, I would like you to keep in mind more those two interpretations, which are not really lotteries, but more like time sharing or resource sharing interpretations. You will see why. Okay, so now the important thing here is that my agents will just have dichotomous preferences over objects. So each agent approves some objects, some outcomes, and does not approve the rest. So we have 0-1 preferences. Okay, so the most simple preferences possible. Okay, so that's assumption. So it's a really a very, very simple model. So an outcome is a lottery over, that's one way to represent the whole problem is actually by a matrix where rows are agents and columns are objects, and we put 0-1 depending on preferences. So the matrix represents preferences, right? So, and our goal would be is given a matrix, for each matrix to find a suitable lottery, which is just a vector of several numbers. The number of those numbers is equal to number of columns, number of objects, so that numbers are non-zero and sum up to one, okay? So it's a very, very simple situation. So we fix N and A objects and agents, and we are looking at good rule, the rule which for each possible preferences, for each possible matrix, spits out a lottery. And the rule should be nice to agents, and I will talk about in what sense it should be nice to agents. We are just a present benevolent social planner which wants to reasonably aggregate people's preferences into a common decision. Okay, so it's very simple. Good. So our main goal here is fairness with respect to agents. We want to treat them fairly. And main concern here in this story will be protection of minorities. Namely, we feel that everyone is entitled to some share of public decision, right? So if I want to watch a sport channel, so sport channel should occupy some fraction of time, Okay, so that's one idea. And also, larger is the group of people who want to watch sport channel, larger should be a fraction of time this sport channel is running on TV. Right? So that's our main concern. But we want to guarantee this protection of minorities to some extent, but we also want to keep in mind standard mechanism design goals. We want allocation to be efficient. And since our preferences are often private information, we want to guarantee that agents reveal their preferences truthfully. Okay, so then we are trying to look what can we do, given that we have those goals in mind. So there were a couple of papers before that, regarding this particular setting and looking at what can happen in this particular model, and I will mention them. So, what is the rule? A rule is specifies for each particular problem, for each particular instance, for each particular matrix, not necessarily just one lottery, but a set of lotteries. The important thing is that so even though a rule could be multivariate in the sense of that it could give a set of lotteries, all those lotteries are assumed to be resulting in a single utility profile. So if I come back, oops. So what I assume is that under a lottery, my canonical utility or your canonical utility is probability that you get an item which you approve, right? Probability that you get an item for which your value is one. And then you only care about your utility. You only care about probability that you enjoy that TV program. So several different lotteries which result in the same profile of utilities for agents are indistinguishable from the welfarist point of view. So we are looking at welfarist lotteries. So we don't care about what exactly lottery is chosen. We care about utility profile, okay? Because agents only care about their utilities. We also assume we only look at anonymous and neutral rules. It's a build up in the definition of a rule. A rule should be anonymous and neutral. It can be easily dealt with, but we will ignore indifferent agents, agents which have all zeros, agents that have all ones, who like everything or who hate everything. And we also ignore useless outcomes, and we include, and we also ignore clone outcomes. Namely, if there are two outcomes who are liked by exactly the same set of agents, then we don't distinguish between them. It can easily deal with, but that simplifies a bit. Okay, efficiency standard strategy proveness are defined as usual. So efficiency is Pareto efficiency. Strategy proveness means that it's not if you misrepresent your preferences, your utility cannot increase. Okay, so nothing special. On the general domain of preferences, if we want a rule to be efficient and strategy proof as and anonymous, we are out of luck. We cannot do it. Now, on dichotomous domain, it's very easy to think about rule which can do it. There is a rule which is just approval voting. Namely, it takes all possible outcomes which guarantee the largest approval, which are liked by the largest number of people, and we average over all of them, and that rule will be anonymous, neutral, efficient, and strategy proof. But clearly, this rule is very bad with respect to providing guarantees to minority, because if I am the only one who likes particular outcome, that outcome will receive zero chance. Okay, so it's not good from our given our main concern. Okay, so in order to provide this guarantee, we introduced the notion of individual fair share, which is a very standard notion, which says that my utility, if there are n agents, should be at least 1 over n. Each person is guaranteed at least 1 over n of utility. Okay, so that's a very standard one. OK, Okay, so unfortunately, we are out of luck here, even on Dichotomous domain. There is a relatively old result, which is already more than 15 years old, which tells that efficiency, strategy, proveness plus individual fair share are not compatible. Well, it's not possible. There is actually a very recent result which says that efficiency and strategy proveness are not even compatible with positive share, fair share. Okay, to everyone. So we cannot guarantee all those three. So given that we cannot guarantee all those three, what can we do? Right? So now I will just propose you, tell you about a few things which we can do. Okay, there will be no characterization results here, but there will be something. Okay. First thing, if you want to guarantee efficiency and individual fair share, a good candidate is egalitarian role, and egalitarian role is a role which tries to maximize the utility of the least happy guy, right? So it takes over all feasible utility profiles, it takes the profile for which the smallest utility is largest possible, and among those, the next smallest is largest possible, etc. So the role which chooses utility profile which maximizes in lexemy sense the utility of least happy guys. Okay? So this role is efficient. It satisfies individual fair share. Everybody is guaranteed at least 1 over n. Given what I told you about a known impossibility, it cannot be strategy proof. It is not strategy proof. On the other hand, it satisfies a very interesting weakening of strategy proofness. Which we call excludable strategy proveness. This means the following. Assume that our outcomes, even though they are public goods, they are potentially excludable public goods. We can prevent people from consuming them, right? So if you have a TV broadcasting by the cable, you can switch off the broadcasting, right? If you decide on what days of the week to organize meetings, you can close the door and not allow some people in. Right? So in that sense, we can assume that if you say that you don't like a particular good, then we can exclude you from consuming that good, even if that good occupies positive share. Right? If you tell that you don't like sport, then we don't allow you to watch sport channel on this 1/6 of the time when sport channel is running. Okay? Under this assumption, it becomes less interesting to lie, right? Because there are less possibilities to profitably lie, clearly, right? So if you assume that people who declare that some goods is of zero value for them, they are not allowed to consume those goods, then under egalitarian rule, it becomes never profitable to lie. So in that sense, rules become incentive compatible. Okay? So if we weaken a strategy proveness to excludable strategy proveness, then actually impossibility disappears. Okay, good. Now, what is the problem with egalitarian rule? Egalitarian rule is very good providing individual guarantees. But it doesn't provide group guarantees, right? Because it does not take into account how many people like this particular channel, right? Because it just maximizes utility of the least poor guy, and whether it's one person or whether it's million of those people, it doesn't take into account. So it provides individual guarantees, but it doesn't provide guarantees to groups, right? So we can, I'm not going, because I don't have time to talk about all possible guarantees, but there are some ways to formalize this idea of group guarantees. The simplest group guarantee is that if we have several clones, if we have out of 100 people, we have 5 clones, then all those clones should be entitled to 5% of utility. Okay, so. If there is a group of people who are single-minded, then they should be entitled, k people, they should be entitled to k over n, not just 1 over n. Okay? Well, there are rules, which is a random priority, which is a standard one, but I don't want to talk about that. There is another one, which is we call conditional utilitarian rule, and that rule just gives 1 over n to each person. And then each person divides this 1 over n between those alternatives which he likes and who have the largest support among others. Okay, and that role is actually strategy proof. It means unanimous fair share. This role is not very efficient, but we have a very interesting facts about that it's not very inefficient, and we can evaluate its inefficiency, and it's not very bad, actually. And in some situations, it's actually, so the inefficiency is small. Okay, and finally, the final candidate is the rule which maximizes the product of utility, Nash product rule. What's good about this rule? Well, this group is efficient. It means not only unanimous fair share, but it means much stronger conditions for the protection of minority, like core-like properties and things like that. Now, it is not strategy proof. It is even not excludable strategy proof. So it's not very good from the point of view of the incentives. Okay, so those are our candidates. Actually, I have even a table which tells us about different rules, how they fare with respect to different properties. So, on a whole, we didn't find any characterization results, but we know that to do everything is not possible. We found several good candidates which meet majority of the concerns, and those which they don't meet, they meet to some extent. So we did an exercise in providing you a kind of a menu of rules which satisfy good properties. So that's more or less the story. We eliminate, you know, for the purposes of the talk, I told you we eliminate people who love everything, and we eliminate people who hate everything, okay? Because they don't matter. You know, majority of those rules, they don't care. Some of the rules, they care a bit. For example, conditional utilitarian cares a bit, but you can adjust it. It doesn't really matter. You can assume you eliminate those people, or you can keep them. It will be tiny adjustment, but the results are not